أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله، الصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعه ولاه، سلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، all praises due to Allah. May Allah's peace and blessings be upon His Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Inshallah, we continue with the series of Hajj, Fiqh of Hajj lectures. Today is the last lecture of that. It's number 5, I think.
No, 7.
Inshallah. So it's a good number. It's number 7. And then Saturday, inshallah, we'll have the workshop step by step. Hajj, inshallah. I mean, logistics and preparation and, you know, the ritual or the religious part of it, and the social part of it, and how to benefit from Hajj and all that. We'll have the workshop this coming Saturday from Asr, inshallah, to Isha. So Asr will be 6:15. Start around 6:30, 6:45. Depends on, you know, how Salah time takes. And then, inshallah, Rabbil Alameen, we'll have 3 lectures, inshallah. And I'll explain, inshallah, that in when we start. We'll have a part presentation. And we'll have part also. We'll simulate certain things, inshallah. Like, you know, the brothers and the sisters who are attending, I'm going to ask, this first time to be done, inshallah, I'm going to ask you for your engagement in certain things. So, you know, how you do tawaf, we'll go around with each other, inshallah, in the musalla here, and how to do the sa'i. So for the brothers and sisters, or the talbiyah, inshallah, I'll ask you to do the talbiyah. I want to see how the brothers and sisters doing it. And Rami will pretend that we are throwing, you know. Oh yeah, we'll do these things. Because it's called a workshop, huh? And inshallah, it's going to be live streamed as well. Our professional camera, inshallah, will be live streaming this lecture. So please tell your friends, anybody going for Hajj, anywhere in the world, يعني, anywhere in North America, anywhere in the world, you know, log in our central time, inshallah, from 6:30 all the way until 9:30, inshallah. So 3 hours workshop on this coming Saturday, inshallah. It will be very nice, fun, as we say, fun, yani, in a good way. Ibadah is not fun, yani, in a negative way, but it is, inshallah, something that you'll enjoy doing, because this is the whole purpose, to enjoy worshipping Allah Azza wa Jal, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like I'm enjoying my tea now, so. Mm-hmm. All right. Today we will talk about some details remaining, inshallah, in the issue of Hajj. We talked last time about the prohibitions of ihram, if you remember. And, you know, them for anybody who will do it. I don't want to get into the details, what is for that, because this is a very basic issue over there. If you have them, you just tell that, we call it them. Dam means blood, huh? But it refers to the expiation for the mistake that you did that violates ihram. Alright? So it's called what? Dam. So hadi is what you slaughter because you are doing hajj tamattu' or qiran. Dam is because of violation. Okay? So just very simply, you go to the admin of your group and tell him, you know, I made after you verify with the sheikh or the religious leader, and tells you owe them, Adam, you got to just go to the group leader and tell him that I owe them, and you can pay them and they will do it on your behalf. Or you can go to any bank, Saudi bank over there, or you will find those small you know, kiosks in front of Haram in Mecca and Medina. In Medina, يعني, if you did not do it in Mecca. So you'll find that those kiosks that you can pay for the hadi or dam or udhiya, or for aqiqah, or for whatever, and they give you a ticket for it. So that's why we're not going to get into the rules and the nitty-gritties of that, since, you know, it doesn't benefit much. Now, as Mecca is haram means people cannot hunt in it, you know, in Mecca in general, and in the Hajj time because of your ihram in particular. Medina also is like that. But it does not have the same ruling. يعني Medina, الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم said Allah, Ibrahim عليه السلام made Mecca sacred, and I am making Medina sacred. So nobody can cut the tree or branches. Nobody can hunt. It's a hunt. Nobody can do these kind of things. Same like Mecca. But in Mecca, if you do that, there is expiation for things, hunting. But in Medina, there is no expiation, but a person becomes sinful. Also, be careful of committing a sin in Mecca or Medina. Like all the good deeds are multiplied, same thing, bad deeds would be multiplied as well. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about Medina, من أحدث فيها حدثا فعليه لعنة الله والملائكة والناس أجمعين. And whoever commit a sin in the Medina or do these bad things, may the curse of Allah, the angels and all the people be upon him or her. You don't want to play with this, do you? So it's very, very serious matter, you know, when you are in Mecca and when you are in Medina, you should respect, should walk with humbleness. You don't raise your voice, huh? Don't raise your voice, don't shout, don't argue, always smile, always be calm, always say the dhikr when you are walking in the street, when you are even shopping and all of these kind of things. So always be calm. Make this 15 days or 3 weeks, weeks of calmness in your life. I know it's very hard. People have temper and all that. You become exhausted from travel. But try to switch, you know, like I'm somewhere else now. I need to be a special person. I need to behave myself, right? So this is, inshallah, will get you the best of that trip, inshallah, Rabbil Alameen. What is preferable when a person enters Mecca? Taban, keep in mind, this changes based on your logistics, going by plane, going by bus, going by train, you are with a group, you are alone. So keep that in mind, okay? Keep this in mind. When entering Mecca, it is mustahab to make ghusl, to enter Mecca. Taban, this you can do when you arrive at your hotel. When you arrive at your hotel in Mecca, even you are in a state of ihram, you can take shower. We mentioned that. It is not prohibited, يعني, to take a bath and clean yourself and look nice before you go do the tawaf. Also, يعني, there are certain hadith saying that, you know, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam enter from certain places. It's not possible now because there are roads and all of that. Also, when you arrive in Mecca, it is mustahabba. Mustahab means preferable to do the tawaf as soon as you can. Yeah, don't delay without excuse. Sometimes I see the group, they're fresh, they're good, they arrive, they took shower and everything, but they said, you know, inshallah, I'll wait until dinner, then I'll take after dinner. And we arrive at Asr time. They go pray Asr and they come back. They pray Maghrib and then come back. They pray Isha and they come back for dinner. And then they go, why, Akhi? Why? Why, my sister? If you could do it as soon as possible. You know, you are eager to come and see the Kaaba and make the tawaf. Why you are hesitating like this? So if you can, without excuse, it's better to do. I'm not saying you are sinful if you delay, but it is better, you know, out of showing Allah Azza wa Jalla that you are so eager that I can't believe that I arrived here, so let me do it. And believe me, Allah, even if you are tired and you go there, subhanAllah, you become fresh and recharged after you come. Believe me, you know, it has a different feeling and a different taste. So this is very important. When you enter the masjid, you say the dua of entering the masjid. أعوذ بالله العظيم بوجه الكريم سلطاني القديم للشيطان الرجيم اللهم صل على محمد وآله وسلم اللهم اغفر لي ذنوبي وافتح لي أبواب رحمتك. لكن دعاء المسجد يعني. When you see the house of Allah, the Kaaba, you raise your hand. It's all mustahabba. All of these are preferable acts. So if you forgot them or you didn't do them, or don't feel bad, you know. But this mustahabba act. To raise your hand and say, Allahumma zid hadha al-bayta tashrifan wa ta'zeeman wa takreeman wa mahabatan. Ya Allah, increase the honor, the greatness, and nobility of this house. And whoever does that and come and visit, please also, Ya Allah, increase their ta'zeem and their takreem. So you want also praying to Allah that, Ya Allah, make this house honorable and that, and anybody visiting it, including myself, also honored and respected and noble. So me coming here, I want to take some of that with me when I'm leaving. So this is also a good thing. So to go al-Hajar al-Aswad, if you can kiss it, fine. If you cannot kiss it, you touch it. If you cannot touch it, you do it. Sisters especially, don't even attempt to do it. Said Aisha radiallahu anha, one time a woman making hajj with her told her, let's go kiss al-Hajar al-Aswad. She said, no, if the men over there, you cannot go If you find an opening and they allow, you go, you go. If you can't, you just, you know, wave and leave. So this is even for the men. Even for men, sometimes we think reverse. You know, if I am strong enough, I can go. Don't go because you are weak, you have asthma, or you have weak. Or so. Actually, it is the opposite. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab, قَالَ يَا أَبَا حَفْصَ إِنَّكَ رَجُلٌ قَوِيٌّ فَلَا تُزَحِمْ عَلَى الْحَجَرِ You are a very strong man, so don't go there because you're going to hurt people. Because he's, mashallah, big muscular. You know, he goes there, 5-6 people on the right, 5-6 people on the left, they are pushed away. Yeah. So I told them, don't go there because you're going to hurt people. These people can kiss Hajar al-Aswad with a little effort. But you go there, you're going to prevent everybody from kissing Hajar al-Aswad. See the reasoning? Reasoning is not to harm others, to benefit yourself. And actually, unfortunately, that's what is happening now. People don't mind hurting others for benefiting, small benefit, which is a sunnah, but they end up violating fard, which is respecting the honor of your Muslim brother and sister. I see many sisters, they go there, their hijab goes down, and men are shoving and pushing and all that. In front of the Kaaba, taqullah, haram, Allah, haram, haram, shari'i, not haram the way we say, no, haram. I mean, this is forbidden for the women and the men to go like this without any excuse. Can be avoided. Can it be avoided? Yes, it can be avoided. So why don't avoid it? It's very important. In Kaaba, when you enter, you don't do tahiyat al-masjid, because tahiyat al-Kaaba al-tawaf, especially first time when you go, no tahiyat al-masjid to rak'ah. That tawaf is tahiyat al-masjid, al-haram. Alright, then we come to the tawaf. For the men, Jalla will show all of these things practically in the workshop. For the men, you start with al-tiba'. Al-tiba', I'll show you inshallah the ihram. Is the rida, يعني the part over your shoulders, like a towel. Imagine a beach towel on your shoulders, okay, but a bigger one. So al-tiba' is like to uncover your right and bring that side of the towel from under your armpit, and it go over your chest and goes behind your left, and you can tuck it in so it becomes tight. يعني it does not keep you don't keep doing that all the time. There is a technique for this, inshallah. So the shoulder, that's called what? At-tiba', means it's under my armpit. That's also from the sunnah of tawaf. And the house, Kaaba, it's called the house of Allah, is in the left. And you start saying Bismillah, Allahu Akbar. You know, waving at al-hajar al-aswad. Allahumma imanan bik, believing in you. Tasdiqan bi kitabik, believing in your book. ووفاء بعهدك fulfilling your covenant واتباعا لسنة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم following the sunnah of Rasulullah and then you start the tawaf. It's مستحب, preferable for men, like that act for men, not for women, to uncover your shoulder. You don't do that. So for men, you uncover your shoulder. طبعا. Some women, by the way, understand that this rule for them, they don't uncover their shoulder, but they are wearing some kind of clothes that they bring it from under their armpit. So their shoulder is covered, but they do that. They think that the sunnah applies to them also by having an extra garment and they put it from under their. I saw that, yeah. But that's not right. The tuba' is for men to uncover the skin, yeah, of the white shoulder. And then the first three rounds, there is something called the ramal. Ramal is that, you know, shaking, moving the body in such a way. Is not jogging, you are not raising your feet. You are not raising your feet. You are sliding your feet, like what they call gliding, like gliding the feet when you are moving and shaking that shoulder. And there's a story for that when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came from Medina first time to do Umrah. They had fever and that weakens the people. So the people of Mecca Mushrikeen, they said, oh, the humma of Medina or the fever of Medina weakened them. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, may Allah have mercy on those who show them the strength. So he ordered them to do this act, to show the right shoulder, and muscular and strong, and also to do this ramal. And then the other four, he told them, calm down now, because they were about to be exhausted. Right, so we showed them. So that's why the message was delivered, and they said, "Wallahi, haulai ajladu minna." Yani those people are stronger than us. So, Allah Azza wa Jal give the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam this wisdom to solve that issue or that doubt. Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab actually thought about stopping it. He said, now Islam is this or that. He said, there is no point for the wisdom for it, but we cannot abandon something that we used to do at the time of. Because even in Hajjat al-Wada', there was no mushrikeen around or anything, but still he did it, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So he said, we cannot, even though there is a wisdom, يعني, there is a reason why Prophet told us, do this because of that. But the reason is not there, yet we have to do what? That. So, أحياناً, يعني انقطع السبب ولكن يبطل يبقى الحكم. يعني sometimes the reason of the ruling disappears, but the ruling itself stays. So remember that also. Not everything with your عقل يعني. Not everything with logic in the deen. That's why many times the youth or people they say why this, why this, why this. Not everything has to be by logic. Otherwise, that means you are the God يعني, who's making the deen. The deen has to be parts of the deen that you cannot use your mind in it. That's the whole idea actually, is not to find logic. And that's how you become obedient, right? Obedient without logic, that's it. So parts will have logic, parts will not have logic. Otherwise, if everything have logic, means you are on top of the religion, you know? I do this because of this. I get it, I understand. But that's not a deen then. You are not worshipping God then. I want that part of hikmah to be there with us all the time. Especially when you're giving da'wah, why this, why this, why this, why this, not everything, why? Not everything you'll have the answer for why, not everything you can ask with why, right? You should ask more with what should I do and how should I do it, the right way to do it. You should ask more for that, of the that way, with the deen of Islam. You should ask, what should I do as a Muslim, man or woman or up or down, rich or poor, what should I do, and how should I do it, and what is the best way to be doing it? How can I please Rabbul Alameen? See, that should be the Muslim's concern. But why this, why this, why this? What does it do anyways? It's like you are saying, if you convince me, it makes sense I do it. If you don't convince me, I don't do it. Or if I do it, I do it without being convinced. Right? So it will lead to a problem. Yeah. Now, so this is the tawaf. Women, you walk easily. Your clothes, we said last time, ihram clothes, your normal clothes. It's mustahab to do as many dhikr and dua. Is there a specific dhikr or dua for tawaf? No. People will have a book, dua of shawt al-awwal, dua of the first round, dua of second round, dua of third round. Alhamdulillah, good. Allah reward you, but don't think it has any preference. There is no specific dua for a specific round from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, more than he say, Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana, fi akhirati hasana qina adhab an-nar. You can recite Quran if you want. Said Aisha said, okay. Tawaf is for dua and dhikr, and Quran is dhikr of Allah. You can read Quran, you can even talk to people, but avoid talking about dunya. Talking about dunya. Wallahi, ya ikhwani, I see people around the Kaaba, they're saying jokes to each other. Joking, and laughing, and all of that. And they go, come on, man, hurry up, pick it up so we can finish and go to the hotel. And come on, this is like salah, but not like that. It takes away from the, you know, this atmosphere takes away. You know, when you hear this thing, it's kind of like, it's like you are in a dream and somebody wakes you up, right? So you are there and mashallah, you're emotional, and you find someone said something, or a phone ring, music comes up. يعني عجيب والله يعني أمة الإسلام يعني. May Allah forgive us. And you say the dua when you see the Hajar al-Aswad, as we mentioned. Also Rukn al-Yamani, the one before Hajar al-Aswad. If Hajar al-Aswad is in this corner, Rukn al-Yamani is the one before it. And you are going like this, anti-clock, right? So you come to Rukn al-Yamani first, Hajar al-Aswad. If you keep to Rukn al-Yamani, you can touch it with your right hand, alhamdulillah. If you cannot touch it, you don't do anything else. If you are so close to it, you cannot kiss it either. Only touch it, if you can. If no touching, no kissing, no waving, this one. No special dua or anything. So you can make other du'as, and mashallah, the books are busy with that. You can hold the mushaf and read, but pay attention to those who are behind you, around you, so you don't step on anybody and nobody hurt you. Tawaf, we have three tawafs when you go to Hajj. Tawaf al-Qudum is the first tawaf when you enter. Qudum means arrival. So first thing you do when you arrive to Mecca is what? Tawaf. And that's part of your umrah if you are doing tamattu, right? That's tawaf. Tawaf al-ifada of the hajj. It's called tawaf al-ifada, tawaf al-ziyara, tawaf al-hajj. All of these names for the same thing. Tawaf al-rukn. This is the tawaf of the hajj. Part of the hajj, pillar of hajj. Then you have tawaf al-wada'. Last tawaf, farewell tawaf. It's like you are saying farewell to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then you have the fourth type, which is the tawaf of tatawwa'. Tawaf al-tatawwa' means nafl. Tawaf, it's like nafl. Tell me, change the batteries. Tawaf of the nafl means any time you enter, you want to do tawaf. Alhamdulillah. And I advise also the brothers and sisters to do more tawaf, because people want to do more umrahs. They go there umrah and umrah and umrah, and then they get very exhausted in the hajj time. So when you arrive, those who go to Mecca first, some packages like this, they go Mecca first 1 week and then go to Medina and then come back to hajj. Yes. And then other group, like most of us here, going to Medina first, then you go to for hajj. But anyways, there are time before hajj. I always advise people, don't do umrah in that time. Don't. But they don't listen. 20 sana, 20 years, people don't listen. And same mistake, you see it in front of you every year. So they go, they're very excited. I'm not doubting intention. Know that? It's done. Ah. So that, I'm not doubting their intention, but they exhaust themselves. So the first week they go to Mecca, they do the Umrah, the Tamattu, then go to Masjid Aisha and Umrah. And next day Masjid Aisha and Umrah. And next day Masjid Aisha and Umrah. Wallah, I had people doing it twice a day. Twice. Umratain fil yom. Wallu haram ya akhi, yani, save your head. Your head is already complaining from the blade. Yani. So they umrah. Now they go to Medina, they get sick. Right? So they are not enjoying Masjid al-Nabawi. Or they go to Medina, they are kind of like, you know, about to get sick. Once they get to Mecca, they get sick. In Arafat, you find them snoring, sleeping in Arafat. What did you do? You see? So save your energy. Inshallah, we'll talk about that also in the workshop. Tawaf al-tatawwa, be careful, make tatawaf, lots of tatawaf. But umrah, sa'i gets you. Sa'i is what gets you, right? And also wearing ihram, you know, all of these things that you are exerting effort to finish. But tawaf, you don't have to go anywhere, right? You are in your normal comfortable clothes. Normally, you just prayed or something. You know, it's cooler weather, you stand, you make tawaf, you take your time, see? So there's no pressure. So that's why you enjoy the tawaf. But sa'i gets you. It will get you sick. So do only what is necessary. I'm not telling people don't do umrah. But I'm saying just be careful. Right? With that. What are the conditions of tawaf? You have to have tahara. Tahara means you are in a state of ritual purity. Means you did not commit, you don't go there in a state that requires wudu or ghusl. Is that clear? You don't go to do tawaf while you are in a state that requires wudu. Means there is wind or urination or something like that. You require wudu for salah, right? You should not supposed to do tawaf in that state. Or requires ghusl. Somebody janaba, have a janaba, you know, state of janaba. Ritual impurity. Major ghusl, major bath needed. For the man or the woman, they had intercourse or something like that. Or the man saw a dream and, you know, he found, you know, wet in the morning. So you have to take a bath. You cannot make tawaf in that state. Or a woman in her period, or a woman who delivered. These acts require to stop plus tahara, right? So you cannot do tawaf at that time, except for necessity for the woman, you know, who is in her period and that, and this is the tawaf of the hajj, and they will leave and there is no option, you know, this is another story, yani. But to be avoided. So tahara is a condition. Tahara is a condition of the of the tawaf. Satrul awra, covering the awra as well. So women, be careful also that your arms are covered, your feet is covered, your hair covered, right? So that's very important. And other than your face and your hand, okay, it's fine, but cover everything else. And the men, your awra has to be covered as well for tawaf. Some people say, of course, who's gonna go tawaf with that awra? Yeah, if you are making tawaf wearing ihram and the ihram is loose and not good, sometimes people cover with the ihram in such a way it is open from the middle, right? It's not done properly. So when they open their leg and walk, you can see the awra. So يعني, the fuqaha or the jurists, when they made these rules, they were not absent-minded. يعني. They actually talking about things that happen. Alright? So satrul awra, covering the awra. It has to be seven rounds. So nobody should go and say, you know, I am making nafil one round only, or two rounds. If you intend the tawaf, you have to do what? Seven. You have to complete it. It is nafil, yes, but it will not count unless it is seven. So be careful when also you are in the physical shape to do that. And of course, everybody knows the closer to the Kaaba, the shorter it is. طبعاً, it comes with the crowd. There are times, actually, that you can do tawaf easily. Remember rule of thumb. After the salahs is a good time to do tawaf. After salawat, يعني. Because most of the people, wait, what they do? They get out of the haram. If you wait 15-20 minutes, people actually start coming for the next salah. So that's your small window right there. Okay? And the best is Salat al-Fajr and Salat al-Isha. This is the best time to do extra tawaf, right? If you want to get closer to the Kaaba. يعني. After Salat al-Fajr, you know, start walking toward the Kaaba. If you are not already there from Tahajjud, يعني, you should be close. If you want a bigger round, roof. Roof. The whole tawaf takes about 1 hour from the roof. If you go easy, يعني, if you go in a nice pace, you will finish 1 hour. Yes, 1 hour, 5 minutes, يعني 65 minutes. Sometimes 55 you finish. 60 minutes, يعني, يعني 1 hour. If you're walking like in a normal pace, you are going to finish in 1 hour the whole tawaf from upstairs, the roof. Around the Kaaba, even with tight crowd, you can finish 20 minutes, 25 minutes, everything. Maybe 40 minutes if it's peak time. So يعني, you have to choose to be close to the Kaaba, and the crowd is not that hard. Okay? And don't go in the heat time because you get a heat stroke. And we'll talk about these things, inshallah, in the workshop, to have water always with you at all times and all of that. Yani Allah Azza wa Jal give us brain to think, right? So always take care of yourself so you can achieve what you went for. Right? When you keep up your health, you perform better. Right? You go eager and push yourself hard, then at the time you need it, you don't find it. إِنَّ الْمُنْبَتَّ لَأَرْضًا قَطَعَ وَلَا ظَهْرًا أَبْقَى. A person who's eager to travel and reach, he destroy his camel and he does not reach. Okay, so this is very important. Be careful when you are doing the tawaf. You know, al-hijr is that arch, you know, the Kaaba. After Hajar al-Aswad, Maqam Ibrahim, comes hijr. They call it hijr Ismail, but it's called al-hijr. Yani. You don't, if, it's not going to be open, but let's say it's open one time and you find people entering. Sometimes they open the door for people to enter. To pray two rak'ah, you consider praying inside the Kaaba. Don't make the shortcut. Some people said, okay, let me pray two rak'ah, and they finish five rounds, for example. They pray two rak'ah, and then they cross on the other side. You missed one tawaf, one round. It doesn't count. So you have to go from above it. I'll give you another one, even more dangerous. When you go around the Kaaba, after Rukn al-Yamani, we said Rukn al-Yamani, let's say here, and Hajar al-Aswad here. You find people lining up in that to kiss Hajar al-Aswad, and somebody, they are standing on a small ridge in the foundation of the Kaaba, right? It's called the Shadirwan, where the big circles that they tie the robes of the Kaaba. So they are standing in front of it. Maybe they are in the first round, second round, sixth round, or seventh round. And they keep walking on that until they reach Hajar al-Aswad. That part doesn't count. Because it's like you are walking on the Kaaba itself. You have to be walking around it. Are you following? Because you get tempted sometime. You know, people are rushing toward Hajar al-Aswad, rushing toward Rukn al-Yamani. Sometimes you find this area empty. Literally. Okay? So some people say, let me go there and stick to the Kaaba until I get to Hajar al-Aswad. So they take one step, that one step does not count in your round. So that one round is not counting. You have to repeat the whole thing. So it's be very careful that you have to do a whole tawaf from outside of the Kaaba boundaries. Okay? And that small, that ridge, it's like about 2 inches out of the Kaaba. 1 inch or 2 inches out of the Kaaba. And it is coming like slope. Like a slope. So, you know, if somebody stand on it, you can stand on it, but you have to be outside of it. So be careful, you know, with that. These are things people do. Tawaf, if a person in the middle of the tawaf get to go to the bathroom or something like that, they should go make the wudu, do the wudu, and come continue from exactly where they, you know, where they needed to leave. And it's better to go a little bit 1 or 2 feet behind, so you just come in the safe side, so you know exactly where, and better to repeat that round, yeah. Right, so if you leave in the middle of the 5th round, inshallah, come, you did 4. That's what you are sure of. You don't want to risk 1 foot in, 1 foot out, when waswas comes, right? So start the 5th and finish. طبعاً, according to Imam Abu Hanifa, you are not supposed to have a long time. If you do long time, you have to repeat the whole tawaf. Okay, so not long time, يعني, it has to be in and out. Sometimes you want to go to the hotel and do the wudu, it will take you 1 hour, right? So according to Abu Hanifa, repeat the whole thing. For sa'i, the area is a little bit, you know, easier. Sa'i, I told you, it gets you, it's hard. Sa'i is hard and longer distance. So sometimes you rest and do the sa'i. Abdullah ibn Umar, يعني, did that a couple of times when he was old. He rests, يعني finish Safa Marwa, tired, maybe you sit 2-3 minutes, 5 minutes, then you pick up again. If a person is tired, yeah. I remember one time a few years ago, I sprained my ankle in there, and I had to do, and it's very, very hard, and I have to do the sa'i of the Hajj. You know, there is no way around it. So, and I did not want to sit on a seat, يعني. I can walk, but the doctor said you have to rest your feet once you feel the pain, right? So you walk, you know, 5-10 minutes, and then you find that the pain starts hitting. So you sit and a few minutes, and then you go again. So alhamdulillah, sa'i is, it's all right, and you have udhr. What are the sunan of tawaf? Is to istiqbal Hajar al-Aswad, looking at Hajar al-Aswad and raising your hand. And you know, or kissing it and all that. This is also from the Sunan. There are many hadith in this regard, like the hadith of Umar radiallahu anhu. He said, if I did not see Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam kissing you, I would not have kissed you, or just a stone could not benefit or harm. The whole idea is obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sunnah also is to do the ramal, I told you, the fast pace. And the Sunnah also is to Rukn al-Yamani, as I told you, also to touch it if you can. What about the tawaf of men and women? If it can be avoided, it should. But if it cannot be avoided, then what you want to do? Even at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the time after, the men and the women used to make tawaf. But it is not like an intentional thing. Oh, let's go party tawaf together, yani. Like our group, let's have the men and the women together and make it. This is not the idea, right? The idea is women are not to mix with men and men not to mix with women. But the Sahaba, the Tabi'een, they saw women and men going, respecting each other, not touching each other. If you find a woman in front of you, or the sister, if you find the men, you know, around, try to avoid if you can avoid. If you can avoid that and walk, you find a group of women, that's better. When you find a group of women, brothers, stay away. You see, it goes both ways. You find a group of women, you find when you are making tawaf, a woman came in front of you, give her space. You know, give space from all around. If she's behind you, make sure she's not touching you. If you are behind her, unless she's mahram, you know, she's your mahram and you are doing tawaf and so on. Can a person doing tawaf ride? Yes, but this is not a preference. Yani. It is, as the yani, ulama said, if you are qadir, if you are able to walk, you should not be riding. Someone said, but why Rasulullah was riding? Especially between Safa and Marwa, said, because people were crowded on him. He was riding the camel so people can see what he does and they relate. Otherwise, you know, they all wanted to see what Rasulullah does. So he had to be in a higher place. So he rides his camel between Safa and Marwa and all of that. But he started the tawaf and the sa'i on foot. Then he ride. So he did not started riding, yani. Okay, so you get the idea. So it is allowed, but make sure it is because of because you cannot do it. And now they have the wheelchairs, right? And they have the electric scooters, like the one you see in the stores. Yeah, they have that as well. Alhamdulillah. Now I saw one time a person who having the hoverboard, electric hoverboard. A brother, strong brother, yeah. And he is with the beard, mashallah, and he is on the electric board with the remote control, and he is like, you know, standing on it, and it is moving, making the tawaf from the second floor. Taban, there was a big debate among the students of knowledge and all of that. We cannot say that his tawaf is void, we cannot do that, but khalaf al-awla, yani he did not do what is better. Is this better for him? No. Better is to use your feet, because you are going to abandon sunan. You know, how you're going to stop in front of Hajar al-Aswad yani, and do the dua? How you're going to do the ramal versus the regular walk? You see, there are many things that will, and now you're pushing people away. People are afraid to be hit by it. So you are making people uncomfortable as well. And many other things yani, it causes. For your own convenience, you're causing all of that. And he's not in a need for it. Yani, if a person is old or something, maybe a need, but there is no need for that. The next time we see somebody with a skateboard and somebody roller skates, it doesn't work like that. It takes away again from the respect and the mahaba of the bayt. I have something maybe people don't say much. If you are sick, don't go in the crowd for with the tawaf. You know, the only people who are that the Japanese, they are, mashallah, very, they are not to avoid sick, but they make sure they avoid the healthy if they are sick. They don't abandon that. And that's actually an Islamic perspective. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prohibited the person who has the flesh-eating bacteria, which is infectious, to make tawaf with the people who make tawaf. Yes, so anything infectious should not. Rasulullah prevented people to come to the masjid if they smell bad, if they smell garlic or onion. Now, if you are sneezing or you have a flu or you have a problem, or you have a skin problem or skin disease or something like that, don't go among the people in the infectious stuff, يعني, right? Don't go among the people. Why? Would you like this to happen to you? Of course not. So I hope we understand that very well, inshallah. If a person is having a flu or sneezing or coughing, avoid to go in the crowd. All right, go from above or go from outside or wait until you are healed, take some medicine and then go. Because believe me, especially in Hajj, one sick person, 1 hour later is 200 people sick. I'm not exaggerating. You go to Medina, once you go to Medina, in the beginning you find like one person sick. At the end you find the whole group sick. Because one person, in the salah. Khalas, you know, seven people here, seven people here, seven lines in the front, seven lines in the back. Next day you find all the masjid, كل المسجد في صلاة الفجر, coughing. Yeah, so inshallah, يعني, we pay attention to these things. And alhamdulillah, now the cleanliness in the haramain and all that reached, mashallah, very high level. They always clean and they always, the floor, Zamzam has the disposable cups. And they have these plastic things in the trash cans. MashaAllah, it's very good. So please respect that as well. respect that as well. Don't throw, don't litter things, you know. Napkin sometimes when you're wearing ihram, so people sometimes you blow their nose or something like that, and then the napkin goes on the floor. You have a bag, as I told you, bag, have always those plastic bags inside of it, right, for your trash. You see these tiny little things, it shows the akhlaq, it shows the morals and the manners, especially when you're coming, mashallah, alhamdulillah, supposed to be educated, coming from America, you know, show these things. And instead of criticizing people, and we ourselves do mistakes sometimes, right? So when you eat, when you walk, when you are around people, when you are, be careful, you know, cleanliness and health, very important concern over there. Very important concern. Drinking from Zamzam also is something good, mashallah. And make dua. Zamzam, if you want to, if you are hungry and you drink Zamzam, inshallah, Allah give you like a meal, as if it's a meal. If you want it for knowledge, Allah give you knowledge. If you want it for children, Allah inshallah give you children. If you want it for rizq, Allah give you rizq. But you have to have yaqeen. Your heart has to be right, sure, you know, Allah will give me this sooner or later. Even at the end of my life, I will get it inshallah. You see? So do it. It's a nice story. Muhammad ibn al-Jazari al-Shafi'i is one great scholar of tajweed and qira'at. He's actually, his fadl, bounty on everybody comes after him from 700-800 years ago. Everybody comes under him. He's the one who collected the Quran and its qira'at and all of that from all of this. His father said that I made a special dua in front of Haram drinking from Zamzam, that Allah gives me a son. Allah gives me a son who serves his book. Subhanallah, he goes home, his wife becomes pregnant, and after 9 months, she gives birth to Muhammad ibn Muhammad ibn Muhammad al-Jazari al-Shafi'i. See? This is very, but you have to have the yaqeen, right? You have to have that real, being 100% beyond any iota of doubt that Allah will fulfill that for you. It will happen. Inshallah, Rabbil Alameen. Yes? It will happen. So dua, when you're drinking from Zamzam, should drink it 3 times, should breathe in between. Like some people, drink without stopping. Drink, Bismillah. You breathe, Bismillah. Bismillah. Dua, after you make your niyya in your heart, then you drink like that. You can wash your face, put in your head, you know. But be careful, because sometimes people insist on doing wudu, while it is written, ma zamzam lishurb faqat. It says drinking only. Actually, you become sinning if you do it for other than that, because there's waqf. You know, waqf endowment, you cannot use it except for what is made for. There is outside, there is zamzam lil wudu. You know, that part is for wudu. But don't do this, because you make mess, people can slip in there, and you are using what is for drinking. So be careful with that, inshallah. Nobody can enter the Kaaba now, but you can enter the Hijr. If you can pray 2 rak'ah after you finish, that would be great as well. If you can make dua between the door of the Kaaba and the Hajar al-Aswad, that's a beautiful place called Multazam. Right? Rasulullah put his chest in there and he make the dua. You tell Abdullah ibn Abbas, this is where you shed tears. And you pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then sa'i between Safa and Marwa. Sa'i between Safa and Marwa. Some of the ulama said it is rukn. Some of them said it's wajib. But do it. It's very important. Don't waste it. Right? So consider it a rukn of the Umrah or of the Hajj. And do sa'i between Safa and Marwa. And explained it before. There is no specific dua in between Safa and Marwa, and you don't have to climb, because you find some people, they insist on going all the way to the furthest part on Safa, all the way furthest part. You don't have to, as long as you are touching the foot of that. And by the way, the main floor is not the ground. The basement is the ground where Safa and Marwa you will find. Then the main floor, then you have 3 more levels for Safa and Marwa, and you can do from either, from each, inshallah, from any one of them. Main floor is the best, but you don't have to climb all the way. Right? As long as you get the whole round and your feet goes a little bit in Safa and Marwa, you can move around, inshallah, Rabbil Alameen. And then there is the dua we mentioned, you know, standing there facing the Kaaba, doing the dua Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did on both Safa and Marwa. For the sa'i to be correct, it has to be after tawaf. It has to be 7 rounds as well. And you start with Safa, ending with Marwa. You cannot start with Marwa and end with Safa, right? And it has to be in the Mas'a. Yani nobody can say, oh, it's crowded here, let me go out of the haram and walk parallel to it. It doesn't work like that. It has to be within the area designated for this. And it has to be following each other. If a person is tired, can rest as we mentioned. Same thing like tawaf. If a person is able to walk, they're not supposed to ride. And the Rasulullah riding was to teach the people. Can a person go to Mina? That's like for tawaf. Can a person go to Mina before the 8th? Yes. If you want to go to 8th in the morning, Fajr, Sunnah to go there is Zuhr. You know, before Zuhr, pray Zuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha, and Fajr of the 9th in Mina, right? If you go Mina before that, that's fine, inshallah. If you go later, fine. If you reach Arafah, Alatul, no problem also, but this is Sunnah. Standing in Arafah, there is no day better than the day of Arafah. Allah forgives all the sins. Allah looks down upon His servants and says to His angels, I forgive all of them. So you want to be among those, inshallah, Rabbil Alameen. Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam gave this glad tiding to the Sahaba. So Jibreel alayhi salam came to me and said, Allah forgive everybody standing here and everybody standing in Muzdalifah and all of that. Sayyidina Umar said at that time, كَثُرَ خَيْرُ اللَّهِ وَطَاب. Goodness of Allah increased to cover everybody, mashallah. And this is the day that Allah releases many of those who are assigned to hellfire already. There is no day that Allah Azza wa Jal forgives people more than the day of Arafah. That's why those who are in Hajj stand in it, on it, and those who are not in Hajj, they fasted. See? Because this is the day where Allah frees people. May Allah Azza wa Jal frees us from punishment of hell. This is the day Shaitan become the most despised and the smallest. Because this is the day of Rahmah and forgiveness. Some of the scholars said, the biggest sinner in the day of Arafah is the one who thinks Allah will not forgive him. The biggest sinner in the day of Arafah is the one who thinks that Allah will not forgive him or her. So when you're in Arafah, have that hope that I am here, I made it, alhamdulillah, and I'm sure Allah forgives my sin. Be sincere, inshallah. Your life will change after it, for sure. If you have that niyyah and intention, Allah helps. Allah will not make you go back empty-handed. Because your intention is sincere, you came all the way and you want to change your life, it will change. بإذن الله تعالى. طيب يعني دعاء also continues all the time. طبعا in the when you are in Hajj, you don't fast the day of Arafah. Everybody don't fast the day of Eid, and you don't fast أيام التشريق. يعني 11, 12. And 13, you don't fast those because Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said this is the time of eating and drinking and celebration, right? So when you are in Hajj, you don't fast those days, and you are not in Hajj, also don't fast those days. We gather in between Dhuhr and Asr and in Arafah. Leaving from Arafah, the person has to have tranquility leaving from Arafah, no rushing. You'll go there and you'll see the Hujjaj. MashaAllah, their fancy package, VIP tents and all of that. And once the Maghrib comes, everybody pushes everybody. They fight on the bathroom to do the wudu. And Rasulullah SAW says, Sakina. Alaykum bis Sakina. Tranquility. Right? So have that in your heart. MashaAllah, things will go easier. Don't be tense. Tension does not bring goodness. And it ends up harming yourself or being temperamental or harming somebody. And people exhausted at that time. By that time, people are exhausted. Like, you know, they leave in Mina to Mina early Fajr. 8th, they're sitting on the floor, you know, the camp, bathrooms, like tight and all these things. And then they go to Arafah all day long. It's heat. They're in the tent for 100 people there. And they become exhausted by Maghrib time. That's why people snap in Muzdalifah. Nobody wants anybody to touch. So everybody calm down after they shave and they relax, you know. But that shows you how to appreciate the level of comfort we are in. You'll appreciate it. Some people want to escape from Mina. I'll do them, I'll not sleep in Mina. Somebody throw for me. This is Hajj. You go there, wallah, it will change you. It's like a camp, boot camp for you. It will change you from inside. To appreciate when you come see your bed, your bathroom, carpet, you know, car, you'll appreciate a lot. You'll thank Allah Azza wa Jal. So that's intended, يعني, you know, to go Hajj and have some of this tough circumstances and atmosphere is very important. So Arafah is very important, Muzdalifah is very important. The day of the Eid, people, you go through the Jamarat first, and the Jamarat is better to be in the Duha time. يعني after sunrise, we pray the, like, you know, Salatul Duha in the Masjid after Ishraq, 15 minutes or so. That's the time to throw the Jamarat, the best time. Sometimes people throw early because they left Muzdalifa early. Go with the logistics of your company. If you can do it in the Duha time, alhamdulillah. Especially if your camp is closed, yeah. Right? If your camp is closed, you can do it in the Duha time, fine. But anyways, the train will bring you from Muzdalifa. Let's say you left Muzdalifa 3 a.m. because the time, schedule, right? You left Muzdalifa 3 a.m. The train drops you 3:30, right in the Jamarat. And your tent is on the other side. So you have to pass by the Jamarat anyways. So you gotta throw. So you gotta throw because the logistics is like this now. If you wanna come back in the Duha time, alhamdulillah, you know, it's a walking distance from your camp anyways. There's no big, don't make a big deal, yani, out of it that the world ended. You know, this is the end of the world, yani, right? If you throw now and you're convinced, not convinced, come throw later. Yani, don't make a mushkil for the group with you. Because some people, they create this issue, right? They speak loud and they make everybody who doesn't know, what, you're making us Hajj haram, yani, create fitna. Sahih? Yani, this happened. I'm just giving you from experience, yani, with good intention, right? But your Sheikh is supposed to be, like after, all right, just calm down, man. Calm down. And all these people are not wrong. And this government did not open it if it is wrong, يعني, right? Missing people, Hajj like that. So just calm down, you know. If you want to do something, we can find arrangement. But don't create an issue for a larger number, right? Jama'ah is like, so be careful. Don't be that guy, يعني. And if you see that person, calm them down, right? Wallahi, Hajj, ikhwan, is not only performing the ritual. It's not that. This is the easy part. Trust me. Easy part. You know what is the hardest part? Dealing with others. That is 90% of this trip. Dealing with others. How others will deal with you, how you react, and how you will initiate. Watch what I'm saying. When you go to Hajj, just watch what I'm saying. From the time you arrive at the airport, see how people deal with each other. Doing the tawaf and sa'i, this is not the big deal, yani. It's important, but this is not the hard part. The hard part is how this changes you. And that's the hard part. Around the Kaaba, people going for tawaf. All of them have good intention to do things right, but they end up fighting with each other. What did they achieve? You see? So is it important, more important to do tawaf? Rasulullah ﷺ said, the life of the Muslim is more important to Allah than the building of the Kaaba itself. We respect the Kaaba. We can kill each other if somebody does something wrong to the Kaaba. But Allah Azza wa Jal loves you to spare the life of the person, even if the Kaaba will not be spared. You see the irony of things? And people will kill if somebody says something bad about Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's great, but they don't follow the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam when they are told. Yeah, love is great, but it should lead you to good actions, not bad actions, not hurting others. The throwing of the Jamarat, 7 only at the time of Eid, يعني the day of Eid, the 10th, 7. Then 2 days after, or 3 days, that's optional, third day, you 21 each day. So what is the total? 7 plus 21 plus 21 is 49. Right? So 21 plus 21, that's 42. And the 7 of the first day, that's 49. So if you are going to throw Eid day, the 10th, 11 then 12, you need to collect 49. You can collect them from Muzdalifa or only collect the seven from Muzdalifa and the rest from Mina, no problem. يعني. No big deal. But the sunnah is seven has to be from where? Muzdalifa. Sunnah. يعني. If somebody did not collect from Muzdalifa, it did not violate Hajj, you know. But, you know, it's okay. Seven for Eid day and then collect from around Mina, you'll find. Yeah. But if you want to collect everything and be in the safe side, 49. And have two or three extra spare. يعني. Maybe you drop one when you are throwing or something. If you are going to do the third day, then you need 70 stone, because plus 21, right? Mostly, those who go from here, they don't stay in the 13, because there is no accommodation. And the camp is only available for you until 12 Asr time. 12 Asr time, they bring it down. So there will be no room for you, nothing. Yeah. Right? So you know, normally it's like that. Other camps, you can stay. But this VIP camp comes down very fast, the 12th. What is the point of Rami al-Jamarat? Is obedience of Allah. There is some narrations that Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he was about to slaughter Ismail alayhi salam, responding to Allah, Shaitan comes to him in that spot while he's walking, يعني, to slaughter him. That's where everybody slaughter now, the sheep and all that, in that area. So he passed by this area of Jamarat. So while he was taking his son and going, Shaitan comes to him, he throw him seven times. Then after a little bit, he comes again, he throw him seven times. He comes seven times. That's why we do, yeah, the history. But we do it to respond to Allah Azza wa Jal. We are following Sayyidina Ibrahim. We are following Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We are an ummah that abides by the discipline. That's the whole idea. Okay, we obey Allah Azza wa Jal. But stone is a stone, يعني, you know, it's not like. So don't make it logic, and as I said in the beginning, and you know, use your logic and all that. But the logic is, I'm obeying Allah, and Allah loves me to obey Him. How He wants to be obeyed here, I will do it. He wants to be obeyed me by me standing in Arafah like that, I will do it. Muzdalifah like that, I will do it. Do tawaf seven times, I will do it. Wave al-Hajr al-Aswad, I will do it. So the whole issue is like, I'm obeying Allah. Ya Allah, how you want me to obey you here? Do such and such. Yes, sami'na wa ata'an. You see, that's the whole idea. The whole idea of all of this hajj is that. Otherwise, what is the point of standing, ruku', up and down? Yani when I'm in ruku', the logic says, I'm closer to sajda, yani. Right? Right? Don't you think? Yani when you are in ruku' in salah, which one is closer, yani? Stand up, then make sajda? Well, make sajda straight. Should make sajda straight. It should be like, this is the closest one. But Allah said, no, you have to stand up and say, Sami Allahu liman hamida. Yes, Ya Allah, I will do that with love. Fahimtum, Ya Akhwani? You understand the hikmah? Hikmah is not in, oh, ruku' does this and the sujood does that. That's fine. You can think like that. But the hikmah, wisdom is, I love to obey Allah the way He wants me to obey Him. That's the whole idea. Allah wants me to stand first, I stand first. Sit first, I sit first. Walk, I walk. Run, I run. Alright? Throw a stone, I throw a stone. Stop here, I stop here. Hear Labbaika, hear Allahu Akbar, I do it. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. You got the lesson from the ibadah? Ibadah is like that, Ya Akhwani. Don't listen to the doubts of the people. What is that point? Why you stand here? Why women in the back? Why this? Why that? Why? And we forget the whole idea of what should I do and how should I do it and I should please Allah, how should I do that? We forget this important question by why? Yani, relax. Why, what? Allah said, pray five times. Why not seven? Why not four? Why not three? طيب, يعني, is it a yellow cow or orange cow? Is it a big cow or a small cow? Is a cow with two eyes or one eye? Yani, come on, you know? So, don't get there. I'm very passionate about this. طيب, we're almost, inshallah, done. حصى. Don't get by the big rocks. Every year I get asked that question. And everyone, you have 100 people in the group, all 100 people want you to check the size of the. So I am the sheikh who check the size of the hijara, standing there and people are coming. Is this good? Is this good? Is this good? Yeah, use common sense. I tell people rule of thumb. which one would you like to be hit with in your head? So if it is okay, which one you like to come in the back of your head? I want a small one. I said, okay, this is the one you pick. All right? Because, you know, you want to hit someone with it and you don't want to hit someone else. So people sometimes think the bigger, the better. Yani, shaitan is going to have all kind of bruises and all kind of things. We are not mocking. Who knows? Maybe shaitan really gets hit with it. Allahu a'lam, right? But we are responding to Allah. But Rasulullah specifically said, مِثْلَ يعني حَصَى الْحَذْفِ. You know, it is heavy, it can travel, but it's small, it does not hurt. You see the rule? Like a chickpea or a little bit smaller. You know, it's not like the beans, like الفول يعني, the garbanzo beans or whatever, it's not like that. الفول, you know, فول مدمس, it's bigger. And it is not like the lentil. It is in between, يعني. Chickpea, you know chickpea? A medium size or a small chickpea. So when you throw it, it travels 10 feet or so, and it does not hurt if it hits someone. Yeah, we throw. Some people, subhanAllah, they become very scared because they hear things. Now it is not like before, يعني. I saw before. From far away, and they start throwing because they're scared of the crowd, and it does not reach. And then it doesn't count. You have to make sure it comes to the pool. There is a pool around, you know, now. Make sure that it goes. Not, you don't have to hit the wall. يعني. Even if you hit the wall, they made it in such a way that it does not come back at you. Yeah, they made it in such a way, subhanAllah, engineering, very nice. يعني. Very nice. So if you hit, it does not, you know, bounce back. It will go down in the pool. But if you, it's better to do. And if you go in a, يعني, you give it a few minutes from the start time of the zawal and all of that, you give it a few minutes, 15, 20 minutes, max, you will find people go. I saw people with wheelchairs even throwing jamrat. Wallahi, no big deal يعني, now. So no excuse of doing this and doing that. يعني, just stick with the sunnah time. نعم. طيب, inshallah, يعني, we done basically most of the things. And then, you know, people go after that, sleep those days in Mina, the 10th at night, the 11th at night, and then the 12th they leave after Zawal and after throwing, they leave. Taman tawaf is done on the 10th, tawaf al-hajj, sa'i of hajj. Shaving happens before. And after you throw the jamarat, the hadi is slaughtered, then you shave or shorten the head, and the sisters take from that, and then you wear your normal clothes, and then go for tawaf in your normal clothes. The only time you do tawaf al-hajj in your ihram, if you left from Muzdalifah, went straight to the haram. Tawaf first before rami or anything. يعني. Sometimes it happens like that. But normally you'll find you'll do tawaf al-hajj in your normal clothes. But umrah in ihram. So pay attention to that as well. This brings us to the end of the hajj and all of that. I advise everybody, inshallah, to read also a simple book in Hajj. You'll find those lectures. Listen to them, inshallah, Rabbil Alameen. And in the workshop, we'll go over the things that we did not go over. And the workshop mostly is about behavior, is about your health, is about logistics, and also is about the performance of the Hajj. But the Hajj itself is simple. يعني. In 10 minutes, you can finish everything. You know, you come, enter the miqat, wearing ihram, having the intention, saying labbaik, Allahumma labbaik, tawaf, sa'i. طبعاً there are sunan, like salah and zamzam and all that. Sa'i, and then shorten or kida, umrah finished. And you change your clothes and everything. Wait until the 8th. 8th, you go in Mina, Zuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha, and Fajr. And then we move to Arafat, you know, pray Zuhr and Asr at the time of Zuhr. Stay, make dua, Maghrib time, you move to Muzdalifah. You pray Maghrib and Isha at the time of Isha, pick the stones, you sleep, wake up in the morning, pray Fajr, make dua, if you can, يعني, stay in Muzdalifah. Then go, rami jamarat, you know, throwing the jamarat, slaughter the hadi, or be slaughtered for you, then shave your head, change your clothes, go do tawaf and sa'i, hajj is done. You see, even not 5 minutes. But the whole idea is, while you are there, how you carry yourself. That's what people overlook. They only want to do the actual thing. Actual thing, يعني, I just mentioned to you in a minute. But The whole idea is you are there to obey Allah. You are there to be washed, come back like a newborn child. You want to change your life to the best, and you want to treat everybody the way you like to be treated. You want to become a changed person. So don't let anything take away from that or distract you from achieving that. Is that clear? Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. We'll see you Saturday, inshallah. From Asr time. Jazakumullah khairan.